Hello and welcome to Become the Teapot. I'm Iain.
And so am I. And this is a podcast where, under normal circumstances, we'd be comparing a film to the comics that inspired it. We won't be doing that this week, however, as this is our very special first anniversary episode.
If this is your first episode, where have you been for the last year? I would recommend that you pause and you go back and listen to our last 26 episodes. Yep, we'll wait. Right, now you're all caught up, let's continue.
To mark this, quite frankly, momentous occasion, we're going to be taking a look back over the show so far. We'll be discussing our favourite comics.
And films that we've covered in the last 12 months.
Then we'll be hosting our very own prestigious award ceremony.
Capping things off with a look at the year ahead.
So roll out the red carpet.
Pop on the kettle.
And join us as we become
the teapot. So, shall we recap what we capped in the New Year's episode?
Okay, yeah, no, wait, so you want to do a segment called New Year's New News in Review, or New Year's New News Review?
Review New Year's New News.
Something like that.
Something that rhymes.
So at the beginning of the year, we did a bonus episode where we discussed all of the recent Disney and very small amount of DC news about upcoming superhero films and TV shows. And we thought it'd be fun at this point to revisit that and see how wrong we were. So WandaVision, obviously that was the first thing released this year from Marvel. At the time you said you were looking forward to it. Did it live up to that expectation?
Yeah, we covered half the season in our very special Valentine's Day.
We did.
Sorry, girls, we're taken. But yeah, so it was probably the most intriguing season.
Mm.
And the idea and the premise was something that, well, I always had questions. And I was like pondering what they were going to do or how they're going to answer that.
Mm.
But yeah, overall, I think really strong start to this new world of TV shows within the MCU.
Yeah, no, I agree, because it wasn't meant to be the first one. I think Falcon and Winter Soldier was meant to come out before it, and then obviously it had to be rewritten because there was a storyline involving a virus, which obviously wouldn't have gone down too well.
Ew.
So it was my most anticipated series, I think I remember saying in that New Year's episode, and yeah, it did live up to my expectations. I did think it went downhill a bit towards the end. The last couple of episodes in particular, it just sort of resorted to that whole Marvel CGI clashing against each other, you know, people with the same powers doing the same thing.
Yeah, that last fight scene with Wanda and Agnes, very much like, oh, pew pew, CGI fight. Yeah, cool.
Yeah, when the rest of the show had been so intriguing, as you say, and a bit different and off kilter and interesting, just having it be a very generic ending was a little bit of a disappointment, but it's not enough to sour it overall. I'd say probably out of the Disney Plus stuff we've received so far, I'd say WandaVision is probably still up there at the top for my favourite of the four series.
Mm, intriguing. Mm.
Moving on then, The Falcon and the Winter Soldier came out afterwards. Mm-hmm. You said you were excited to see the relationship between the characters. I said it was my least anticipated and looks like Captain America 4 without Captain America. So...
Yeah.
What were your thoughts?
Well, yes. I mean, a great continuation of the story arcs with Falcon and the Winter Soldier. And even they brought back Sharon Carter and Zemo, which is always fun to watch him dance. But yeah, I did like how they explored the post-blip life and what would happen if half the world just came back. And that was quite good. And obviously there was the setup to Cap 4.
Mm.
To be fair, I did fangirl a little bit when I first saw Falcon in the Cap kind of outfit. That was pretty cool. That was quite comic accurate.
Okay.
Yeah, I enjoyed it overall and I thought it was fine.
Yeah.
To provide a separate perspective, Kate has watched all of these alongside me, but she phased out halfway through the season.
Yeah. No, I can see that. I think fine is probably how I'd describe it as well. It was just another Marvel thing, but slightly more drawn out.
Mm.
So yeah, it wasn't my favourite. There were some good bits and I did enjoy it generally. I've not disliked anything so far that's come out of this, but it wasn't my favourite. It's probably my least favourite of the four series we've got so far.
I would say that, yeah. The premise itself is not that intriguing, comparing it to WandaVision, which just came out before this aired.
Well, I think I said at the time is the thing that they could do with the Disney Plus shows is be a bit different from the films and actually taking risks with it. And this show just didn't. It was just a film.
Yeah.
But I was right about US Agent, so I'm quite glad about that. I said I hoped he wasn't just going to be a standard villain. Mm-hmm. And he didn't. No, he turned into quite an interesting character. So I'm glad it went that direction.
I don't like saying you're right, but you were also right about the bad guy or the bad girl in WandaVision. It was Agatha all along.
It was indeed. You must be used to me being right by now. So, next up, we've got Loki. Mm-hmm. You didn't say much about this in our bonus episode. I said something about, I think, that Loki was holding on to Mjolnir and it was CGI'd out. I was very wrong about that. But I think we both said we were looking forward to something a little bit different.
Yeah.
So, now you've seen it, what do you think?
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. It was great. Great way to introduce the multiverse and the future of the MCU as well. I mean, we spoke about this off air. The first episode is very heavy on the... Let's sit in a room and talk about stuff.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, I kind of liked. You need to make the Loki from Avengers into a caring character like he was at the end of Thor 3, whatever it was.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I enjoyed it. It was like a space MCU version of Doctor Who, even though Doctor Who is still space.
Yeah, and he had Marvel Comics at one point.
Yeah, he did, yeah.
But yeah, I liked it. I did think it was a bit slow to start. I thought there was a lot of exposition in those early episodes. Mm-hmm. Just a lot of people sitting in rooms and explaining the plot. But it did pick up towards the end, definitely. I loved Richard E. Grant in it.
Yeah.
I wasn't entirely convinced by the romance plot, but I'm willing to see where it goes in series two. Yeah, definitely enjoyable. Again, it's up there.
Yeah.
And then last of all, of the Disney Plus stuff, we've got What If. We, at time of recording, have just finished the fifth episode, I believe.
Yep.
Which is What If Zombies.
Fantastic.
So, you said at the time that this was your most anticipated show. You were really excited to see it. Mm-hmm. Did it live up to your expectations?
Yes. Like you said, up to now, the first five we've had. I mean, this even came up a few weeks ago on the podcast. We spoke about Captain Carter. Mm-hmm. That one, to me, was all right. It's a nice introduction. This is what would happen if this one small thing changed, but the overall story would be very similar to the first Captain America film.
Yeah.
But then when you go on to T'Challa and then the Doctor Strange one and the zombies, it's just they are building to a lot more extravagant stories rather than just let's change this one small thing and watch a film play out in half an hour.
Yeah, they definitely started off with the least ambitious plot. It was very much this is going to be roughly the same but slightly different to ease people in, and then they went balls to the wall, everything's different from one decision.
Yeah.
Some of them, I think, are leaps of logic. Mm-hmm. You know, the best What If storylines in the comics were always the one where a small thing changed.
Yeah.
One possible outcome of What If changed things irrevocably. Whereas, for instance, the T'Challa episode was What If a completely different person kidnapped him and then his whole life was different and everything changed after. It was like, well, hold on, that's not a decision that someone has made at any point. That's just a random thing that's occurred. Because you've decided to go, what if Captain America was Iron Man? Well, okay.
Oh, that's episode 6. to be fair, that's episode 1.
Okay, yeah, it is actually.
Steve Rogers is Iron Man.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. But no, I'm liking it so far. I think they're varying quality, but they're enjoyable half an hour romps. I think as long as you're not expecting them to have the same world-altering stuff like Loki,
yeah,
you know, it's to have a massive impact on the MCU going ahead. If you just take them for what they are, which is little half an hour stories, then yeah, very enjoyable.
Yeah. What was your favourite one so far then out of the first five?
My favourite one so far is the Doctor Strange episode, definitely.
I think the last three have been pretty strong. It's probably going to be the zombies one for me because it's just filled with like typical zombie film tropes.
Yeah.
And the way that Peter Parker's character is in it. You know, there's that guy from Scream says about all the horror rules. It's like him.
Yeah, Shaggy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like that. And also the Futurama style heads in a jar. I loved it.
Well, we'll see, because obviously we talked about Captain Carter a few weeks back, and we predicted, or I predicted, that there would be some sort of meddling from the Watcher. He has now spoken to the main characters, and we will see if he interferes even more in the weeks ahead, if there is going to be some sort of crossover, but we'll see.
Is there 9 total?
There's 9 in total, so there's 4 left, yeah.
Do you reckon he'll interfere, like, episode 7 or 8?
I think it's probably going to be episode 9.
Episode 9.
It's got to be the finale, isn't it? Yeah. Moving on to the films then. So, at the end of our New Year special, we talked very briefly about DC's output, or lack of output. So, Wonder Woman 1984. What are your thoughts about that?
Still haven't seen it.
No, okay, fair enough.
I've not heard great things, so I'll watch it at some point. Probably when it's out on Blu-ray.
I think it is already out on Blu-ray.
Oh, well. I'll go buy it.
Yeah, so neither of us had seen it at the time because it was out on HBO Max, not HBO Plus, and we don't have that in this country, so neither of us had seen it. I have now seen it, and I kind of wish I hadn't. It wasn't very good. It had moments. It had moments in it, but it was just generally a bit forgettable. Pedro Pascal was good.
Yeah.
I liked him as the villain. Chris Pine, very charming whenever he turns up, but completely pointless in the film.
Wow.
And then there's some very questionable things in there as well. So I wouldn't rush to go and see it.
How was Kristen Wiig or something as the cheetah?
Cheetah.
That one. How was she?
She was fine at the beginning in that sort of... She was basically playing, you remember Catwoman in Batman Returns?
Yes.
Where she starts off as like a nerdy secretary, then she falls out of a window, gets licked by cats, and she comes back as Catwoman. It's that sort of thing.
It's the same thing.
It's that same transition, yeah, but with a cheetah.
lick her face.
And there's a magic wishing stone in it, which was just weird. Anyway, the other film we talked about from DC was, we briefly touched upon Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Mm-hmm.
At the time we discussed the rumours that it was going to be R-rated. Of course, that did turn out to be true.
Yep.
So I think we have talked on the podcast about this before, but what did you think of it briefly?
Yeah, I mean, putting Zack Snyder's tragic reasons for not being able to finish, I mean, I guess you can polish a turd. It's definitely an improvement, but it shouldn't have been 4 hours long. It should have been two films, really, but...
It's still a turd, though, isn't it? That's the thing. A polished turd is still a turd.
It's a shiny turd. I mean, it's an improvement, I would say that, but it's far too long.
Yeah. It feels more cohesive than the original, which mm-hmm. felt all over the place, understandably, because there was two different directors and studio interference and all sorts of other things, and then it had been cut to within an inch of its life.
Yep.
But like you say, there's no good reason for that simplistic a storyline to be 4 hours long. It's just bad storytelling. If you can't tell that story in 2.5-3 hours at most, you are doing something wrong. You just could have cut the slow motion out and you would have saved half an hour, and all that bullshit errata thing at the end of it, whatever that epilogue was with the Injustice universe. I mean, just rein it in. Someone just needs to be there next to Zack Snyder just saying, rein everything in, all of those impulses.
No.
Don't do them.
Stop. That's a bad Zack Snyder.
It wasn't good. It wasn't good. And I'm really confused by the adulation that it gets from certain crowds. I don't understand it at all, and I never will, I don't think. But hey.
But hey ho.
Right, back to the Marvel Universe then. So Black Widow came out earlier this year
mm-hmm.
on dual streaming Disney Plus and the cinemas. Which one did you watch it on?
We watched it at home on Disney Plus.
Mm.
You?
I went to the cinema.
Ooh. Ooh, you had some popcorn?
No.
No, I hate popcorn, which I love.
It is a loud... Why would you eat loud food at the cinema? It makes no sense.
But yeah, this film came out way too late.
Mm.
And I don't mean because of the virus and whatever. I just mean this should have been out like 4 years ago. They should have brought this in like phase two, phase three.
Well, it's its storyline between Infinity War and Endgame. Right?
No, so it's Captain America Civil War.
That's it. Yeah. So it should have come out after that then.
Yeah.
Before Infinity War. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it fills a gap. I don't think it was a very strong film.
No.
It had a very phase one vibe. I mean, I've watched it once and I can't remember a lot of it really.
Yeah.
It was all right.
Yeah, no, I didn't think it was bad. It was all right. It was definitely all right. It just felt like they had a bunch of scenes already filmed and put together and they had to sort of thinly paste it onto a storyline. I liked all of the family relationship stuff, especially with Yelena and, you know, all of that.
Yeah.
But when it wasn't doing those bits, I just felt the whole film was quite weak in those other moments. It felt quite forgettable.
Mm.
It's definitely ended up in the sort of bottom third of my Marvel ranking order of 25 films or whatever. So it's definitely towards the bottom.
Yeah, it's all right. I'd rather watch Infinity War and Endgame again, as in sit down and watch them both, than probably watch that again.
Yeah. I would probably prefer to watch our next film, which we went to see together, which doesn't happen often.
We did.
At the cinema. We went to see Shang Chi.
I'm so glad you pronounced it correctly.
So, we haven't talked about this, by the way. We left the cinema. We refused to talk about it with each other because we're saving it for the podcast. Without spoilers, obviously, for those who haven't seen it yet, what were your thoughts?
I think it was a very well-balanced film. A lot of heart and soul to it. The fight scenes, I mean, as you expect, fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
A few long shots, so the camera follows the action. They weren't too choppy, as what we've seen previous films.
Yeah.
But overall, really good, I thought. Yourself?
Yeah, no, I definitely enjoyed it. I think it's one of the stronger origin stories.
Yeah.
It's sort of up there with Ant-Man and Black Panther are two of the stronger origin stories so far, and it's sort of in that sort of mix for me. I don't think it's going to break top 5, maybe not even top 10, but mm-hmm. it is a very strong film. I generally prefer the first 2/3 to the last third.
Yeah, I can see
that. Those more hand-to-hand fighting and stuff like that, more of that as opposed to what you get towards the end of the film. But
yeah.
Obviously I'm trying to veer away from spoilers there, but yeah,
yep.
It was very enjoyable. As a fan of martial arts films in general, I really enjoyed all of that. And seeing people from martial arts movies crop up, and obviously the Mandarin being excellent.
Yeah, I also loved the Jane Foster cameo.
What?
Oh, sorry, you said there was no spoilers.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Wink. Yeah.
Wink.
I thought it was strange when Tobey Maguire turned up.
And punched Andrew Garfield in the face.
No, I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
In fact, what we said at the time, you were looking forward to the Mandarin done right. And I agreed and said they've got an excellent actor. And I really do think that is the film's strength as well. Is that villainous role, Tony Leung, just excellent in that role. It mm-hmm. really is one of my favourite Marvel villains.
Yeah, they've got a very bad history of the villains being a one and done kind of, oh, he's big and bad and evil, oh, he's gone now.
Yeah.
Which I think, depending on what happens in the future, because there's all sorts that could happen.
Exactly. Spoiler free.
Well, this is one of the stronger guys that you think, that's also where the heart and the soul comes from.
Yeah.
It's the whole, it's all the characters are like one family in a way.
Yeah.
It's fun to watch. I'd rather watch the continuation of this story than be like, oh, you know that dark elf in Thor 2 that died? Let's bring him back.
You don't want to see Christopher Eccleston come
I would love to see Christopher come back, but in a role that actually would do him some, you know, well, a role that would provide him a more interesting role. Whatever I'm saying,
yeah.
You now talk.
Whatever you're saying, the dark world sucked.
Yeah.
No, yeah, I think the performance of Wen Wu was amazing. Is I think that was, like you say, where the heart and soul of that film comes from. And he just does so much with so little, you know, in terms of his very still actor. It's all in the face and in the eyes, you know, mm-hmm. and he can convey a lot of emotion through a very small gesture. I think he's an amazing actor. There's a reason he's one of the most critically acclaimed actors ever, but also in Hong Kong cinema.
Yeah, I also said to Kate on the way home that I can't believe it's taken them this long to get pretty much an all-Asian cast.
Mm.
I'm not saying this is the first film ever to do that.
No.
It's turned it into a summer blockbuster. It's fine. It's taken them 25, 26 films to go, right, summer blockbuster. All the characters have been cast correctly.
Mm.
And this is now going to be a well-known film because it's part of the MCU.
Yeah. The same thing happened with Black Panther. And obviously that film is really well regarded because of that, because it was great representation on a larger scale. And this is going to be the same, I think, for Asian communities.
Yeah.
But above all of that, it's a great, enjoyable film. I think that's the most important thing.
One last thing before we go on to our next segment.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's not really Kate's opinion time, but she did say that she got vibes from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yeah.
It was just the way it's been shot and a lot of the fight scenes, it looks so good on screen.
Yeah, well, it's definitely wuxia inspired mm-hmm. in terms of martial arts films. Obviously, there's different types of martial arts films. That exact style, like you say, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, House of Flying Daggers, Hero,
yeah.
All of that is very much inspired by that, as was, you know, films like The Matrix. That sort of martial arts, as opposed to the Raid style. There was a little bit of that, but
I've heard the Raid's not that good.
I saw that. I saw that on Twitter, that someone has said the Raid is not that good. And all I can say is you're wrong and you should feel bad about your opinions.
And also, you should know who you are.
Yeah. And you're not coming back on the show.
Damn it. Oh, I can't come back on the show.
Right. I think that's the recap of the New Year's New News in Review, or whatever we were calling that segment. Shall we move on to... Well, looking back across the episodes we've done so far, the rest of the episodes.
Yeah.
We started this podcast because we were in a pub and we thought it'd be fun.
Pretty much.
And we wanted to discuss films and comic books. And I wanted to get you reading more comic books in general. So the central premise, we watch an adaptation, we read the comic. So in terms of the adaptations we've watched this year,
mm-hmm.
26 different films or TV shows. What would you say your top three adaptations were?
Yeah, so... I've not put these in order
mm-hmm.
because I can't say this is my top film because I love a bunch of them for different reasons.
Yeah.
But when we're talking about adaptations, in my top three would be Scott Pilgrim.
Mm-hmm.
Because I always forget how much I love that film. I might not watch it for years, and then I'll go back and go, oh, actually, I love this film. Why don't I watch this every day? Yeah, so Scott Pilgrim is up there. So is Guardians of the Galaxy,
mm-hmm.
purely because it's one of my favourite MCU films, maybe even one of my favourite films of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And Sin City.
Okay.
Purely because it's, you know, it's so close to the comics. It's something that I watched years ago, and I then went away afterwards and read all of the 6 or 7 books.
Yeah.
So I read that years back. It is pretty much like I saw the book put on screen.
Yeah.
You know, they've used that as a storyboard, and it's been done really well, in my opinion. Obviously, we covered that in an episode, so go watch that.
Yeah.
Listen to that.
Absolutely. Go and listen to it.
Did you order them? So, like, your top of all time?
I did order them, yeah. Of course I have.
You did order them? Okay. Let's do a Iain rundown. So number 3.
Number 3. I've actually put an or here, so I have cheats. Like Captain America, The Winter Soldier, which you actually didn't watch because you weren't here. You were moving.
Mm-hmm.
Or Guardians of the Galaxy, depending on my mood. But I think Winter Soldier takes it. They're both, however, in my top 5 MCU films. I really enjoy both of those. I can watch them over and over again. But I think Captain America takes it just for that fight scene on the overpass on the motorway. Really good stuff.
Cool.
Number
2.
And number 2, it's Batman Begins, the Christopher Nolan film. I know that The Dark Knight is probably the better film in general, but I prefer Batman Begins, and I think it's a better superhero film.
Oh.
Whereas The Dark Knight is an excellent crime film.
Yeah, I can see that.
And last of all,
number 1.
Number 1, it's Scott Pilgrim versus the World. So making an appearance in both of our top 3, definitely one of my favorite films. Absolutely endlessly enjoyable. I can go back to that over and over again. I know it has its quirks and it has some problems and it has pacing issues, but it doesn't matter when it's that fun. I enjoy that film immensely.
Fantastic.
So, that's the favourites out of the way. What would you say your least favourite adaptation is?
I mean, this is a very, very close battle between two.
Okay.
I inevitably picked the League of Extraordinary People. The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Mm.
But yeah, like I said, X-Men 3 was a very, very close second.
Okay.
It came down to, if you put them both down and said, watch one of these films, I'd probably watch X3 again.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Is it shorter?
It's shorter and it's it's funnier. It's not a comedy, but it's hilarious.
Just for that whole bridge thing.
Yeah.
Got dark.
And
yeah, no, that's fair enough.
What's your least favourite adaptation then?
So my least favourite, I'm going to have to say Watchmen.
That intrigues me.
I don't think it's the worst film that we've watched necessarily.
Uh-huh.
You know, that would probably be something like Green Lantern or The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. But Watchmen is by far the biggest waste of potential, and therefore it's the most disappointing for me. It's also the longest, so it can just fuck right off.
Yeah, okay. I understand why you've chosen that.
Yeah.
I mean, you're wrong. I get your point. I get why you've chosen that. It's, yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah. As I say, it's not necessarily the worst film we've watched. It's just my least favourite by far.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's the adapted media. But what about the comic books? That's what we're getting you to read here. So what are your top 3 comics that we've covered in the last year?
Like my films, I've not ordered them, but the way I've written them down, I'm looking at them now, I'm thinking, actually, yeah, I agree with the way I've written them down.
Okay.
So I would say number 3 would be The Long Halloween.
Number 3. Sorry, missed my cue there. Okay, no, that's good, right? Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's a great story. It actually inspired my sister to read it after she heard the episode.
Oh, right.
Because she was like, who's the killer? Tell me who the killer is. Like, no, that's one bit where we won't spoil.
And did she enjoy it?
Yeah, she did, actually.
Good.
And I like that sort of crime story, that sort of, you know, there's a killer on the loose, who is it kind of thing.
Yeah.
It was intriguing and I enjoyed it. And I think the fact that I knew the characters before going into it helped a lot as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And then my second favorite.
Number two
would be Grand Designs, X-Men.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, that was a really good one, yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't have... That's not something that I would have picked up without you saying, go read this. You know, it's not your basic comic. It's a different retelling of 60 years or whatever it was. But yeah, it's really fun and really entertaining.
Yeah, no, I really enjoyed it as well. And that was one of the few that I was reading for the first time. I finished all three of those because we only read the first volume for this show.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, excellent. Excellent comic book. I've also now gone out and purchased, got on that table over there, Hip Hop Family Tree, which is from the same author, Ed Pisker. So it's a history of hip hop. So it's all about Grandmaster Flash and things like that from the beginning, the early days of hip hop. But yeah.
Interesting.
Same style, sort of same sort of thing. And what's at number one?
Number one is Watchmen.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
You did enjoy it then.
I did, yeah.
You were down on Alan Moore initially.
I was pissing all over him when I... Yeah, I think I had a bad taste in my mouth because of his previous work.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't feeling great when I read V.
Yeah.
League took me a while to get into. But I think out of all the comics that we've read in the last year, Watchmen's probably the one I'll go back to and spend more time, you know, rather than trying to cram it into like a week, space it out and read it all again and go into each character and all this sort of stuff.
Yeah. It's definitely one of the comics that I've revisited most in my life in terms of going back and rereading them. Interesting.
What are your top three?
Well, I've noticed that even though we've covered some of my favourite Marvel and DC runs in the show, you know, we covered Captain America by Ed Brubaker, Green Lantern by Geoff Johns, and X-Men, particularly God Loves, Man Kills by Chris Claremont, all of my ultimate choices were self-contained titles. They weren't from Marvel or DC, as it turned out. But at number three, it's... Oh, sorry.
Number three.
Thank you very much. It's Persepolis by Marjane Satrapi, which you didn't read again. I think you bought it for the show.
I bought it. Mm-hmm. I have it. I've watched it, not read it.
You should definitely read it. The comic is better than the film. I enjoyed the film, but I think it was missing a few key aspects. I was reading this one for the first time as well. It's one of these autobiographies that it's always spoken highly of amongst comic book fans. You know, people who know about these things recommend it as an early read. And I can see why. It's an excellent comic book.
Nice.
And at number two.
Number two.
It's a reappearance for Scott Pilgrim. Scott Pilgrim by Brian Lee O'Malley. The whole 6-issue run, of which I finally own all of the hardcover editions.
I did notice.
And yes, absolutely excellent. And again, whenever I revisit that, it makes me smile. I find new stuff to laugh at. It's a great little story. And at number one.
Number one.
It's Watchmen by Alan Moore. Yay. So we are in complete agreement on
and
that.
The and the crowd say, goes wild.
So does that mean we've got a consensus? The best comic book that we've read in the last year is Watchmen?
I'd say so. Yeah. Scott Pilgrim is a very, very close second. I mean, that's not in my top three, but I kind of felt I couldn't involve Scott Pilgrim in both my top threes.
You absolutely can.
But I think I would rather read The Long Halloween again than read Scott Pilgrim again. Because, it's more intriguing, I find.
You're using that word a lot today, intriguing. Is that what you look for?
I am, yeah. It's just my word of the day, I guess.
You got one of those calendars.
Yeah, but I think Watchmen... It's been known to be the best comic of all time or the best graphic novel.
Technically a comic, but...
I mean, is it a comic? Is it not?
Yes, no, it's a comic.
Oh, thanks. Cool.
Yeah, glad we could get to the bottom of that. Right, those are your favourites. What's your least favourite comic that we've read in the last year?
Ooh, I mean, we've read a couple of comics that I've not been fans of.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said earlier, wasn't feeling great when I read V.
Ooh.
But I am going to say The Old Guard.
Oh, okay.
This is one of the most recent comics that we've read.
Yes.
But it just seems like a bit of a meh comic. I mean, the premise is great.
Hmm.
But then looking back on it, when you said about the final scenes of five people who can't die shooting down everyone, you kind of go, oh yeah, there's no stakes.
Yeah.
So it's pointless.
Yeah. It was very forgettable.
Hmm.
Definitely very forgettable. I mean, for me, my least favourite is probably Civil War.
I should have predicted that.
Yeah. Again, we've probably read worse comics. We've definitely read more forgettable ones. You know, The Old Guard. Green Arrow Year One. I only realised we read that when I looked back at my notes and went, oh yeah. But for me, it has to be Civil War is my least favourite. How it mischaracterises some of my favourite comic book characters. It just gets under my skin. Some of the tie-ins are good, though. Some of the tie-ins are good, so don't let that put you off reading the rest. But on its own, those seven issues, I think, are full of mischaracterization and largely forgettable.
Yeah, I mean, well, this came up when we discussed it with Josh. But yeah, I mean, that would have been, I mean, like me, almost. It was one of my first comics that I read preceding the MCU.
Mm.
As soon as I hear that that film's coming out, I'm like, right, I'm going to go off and I will read the comic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see why you think it's not a good starting point for someone else.
Yeah, I think it's not a good starting point in general because it's a, first of all, crossover event, which, you know, you have to know dozens of different characters. Mm-hmm. And as I say, they're just, the voices feel wrong to me, especially. So with that in mind, our next question, what to you makes a good adaptation?
Two words, James, and then Gunn.
And that's it. James Gunn.
That's it. Okay. Well, to be fair, all the stuff that I've watched of his comic book properties have been good.
Yeah.
There's been a couple of comments here and there, but overall, if I hear that he's in charge of a comic book film, I think I will love it.
Mm.
But yeah, I mean, I think the properties of the film or the TV show, whatever it is, should be closely linked with the comic. I'm not saying it needs to follow the exact same story or plot.
Yeah.
But I feel like the characters should still have the intentions, or at least the same intentions as the creator portrayed them in the comic.
Right.
And then also, they shouldn't be afraid to take a chance and to change things, but for the better. Stupid clouds. But when you change things and this and that, but it works well if you work with the creator of the comic. You know, think as Scott Pilgrim or Kick-Ass.
Or the old guard?
Well, right. It doesn't always work, and there you go. But
no.
When the writer and the creator work on the film or closely with the film, I think that's an improvement. Not just some random person going, right, I'm going to make a comic book film about Spider-Man. Oh, he's got wings instead of webs. Oh, he's got this instead of that. I'm like, no, now you're just being a dick. You're just changing things for no point, you know.
Yeah.
Any comments on that? What do you think makes a good adaptation?
Well, so for you, a certain level of faithfulness is really what you think is what makes a good adaptation.
Yeah.
Yeah. So a question that I've been asked before is, what does Become the Teapot mean? And it's a good question because, well, it's honestly, it's a pretty stupid name for a podcast. It has nothing to do with the show. But it actually comes from a Bruce Lee quote, which goes like this. Empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now put the water into a cup. It becomes the cup. You put the water into a bottle. It becomes the bottle. You put the water into a teapot. It becomes the teapot. Water can flow or crash. Be like water, my friend. Now, the eagle-eared listener amongst you may have noticed that Lee didn't once mention comic books or their adaptations, so what the hell has this got to do with this podcast? Well, the honest answer is not much. We just liked the name. But it does, in a roundabout sort of way, lead me back to the question on what makes a good adaptation. So, to me, a good adaptation is not about slavishly replicating the comic book. I've already read the comic book. I don't necessarily need to see it again on the screen. Watchmen, for instance. No, what's more important to me is that the film works in and of itself. So if the source material is the water, then the film is the vessel.
Yep.
And that can be a cup, it can be a bottle, it can be a teapot. As long as it's not full of holes, as long as it functions for its intended purpose, then it doesn't matter if you didn't get all the water in, or you had to go and get water from elsewhere and put that in, or if you fundamentally change the water by pouring in some Ribena or something. I may have overextended this metaphor slightly, but the point is, it seems obvious, but a good adaptation is a film or television program that is good.
Yeah.
The Shining is an excellent film. It's also one that diverges massively from the source material. The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen is a terrible film, but its problems don't stem from the fact that it's different from the comic book. Its problems stem from the fact that it's a generic piece of soulless shit. If the film doesn't work as a film first, then it doesn't matter how accurate it is.
Yeah.
That's my take on it.
Wow. Cool. No, it kind of feels that we've got two different perspectives there.
Yeah.
You said this before about, I don't know which one it was, but we've done so many in the last year. When you become afraid to change things, you are literally just going, right, that's the book, that's the screen, done.
Yeah.
You need to change things, hopefully for the better.
Yeah.
Sometimes things don't work, but I think if you do work closely with the original creator or the writer, the artist, something to inspire the change. It doesn't have to be the same. This happens in the book, that happens in the film. This happens in the book, that happens in the film.
Yeah.
But first of all, the actual creator of the film needs to be a fan of comics, I think, or at least know enough about the source material. That's why I said about James Gunn.
Mm.
He's come out and said that he reads comics all the time, and he went back and he read a bunch of the Suicide Squad stuff, and then he did that film, and then he did the same with Guardians. He's not just going, let's just make some money. I mean, that's a positive, I'm sure. But he spends time to investigate these characters and think, I didn't quite like that in the comics, so let's change it. And look at that, it works.
Mm.
Wow.
Sometimes.
Bar a couple exceptions.
Okay. Yeah, I think I get where you're coming from, and it's not having an aversion to change. But, you know, for instance, we talked about Shang Chi earlier in the episode, and yep. That is very far removed from his comic book origins and comic book history.
I mean, I'll say yes, but you'd be surprised. I've not read it.
I mean, there was a huge amount of Iron Fist influence stuff in there, which is strange, because I still just don't understand why they haven't made an Iron Fist adaptation at all.
I mean, it would make sense. They did Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, and then just sort of stopped. I don't get it.
It doesn't make much sense. I am hoping the next Shang-Chi film is Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Iron Fist, and I will...
wet your pants.
Cry my little fanboy heart. So, last question for this segment. What have you learned since we began this podcast?
This might sound weird, considering that we've been friends for years, but I learned that you still watch Doctor Who.
Yeah.
I thought you phased out of it. I thought you stopped watching it and you'd gone, it's a pile of shit now. I'm not watching it anymore. Which, to be fair, a lot of people did go, it's shit now. Bye.
I like Doctor Who a lot. I watch all of it. It's not been my favourite series, the last couple, but I think I liked Peter Capaldi more than a lot of people did as well.
Yeah.
So I'm not completely sold on Jodie Whittaker. It's, you know, her good sort of gurning, running around with her mouth slightly open attack. You know?
Oh, no!
Take on the Doctor.
There's aliens!
Yeah. That's pretty much it. It's a one-note thing.
No, but to give you a more serious answer, I mean, I always thought when I was a kid and when I first got into comics that I had to know all of it, or I didn't know where to start. I realised that in this, over the last year, you can literally pick up kind of any comic in a way and just go, right, I'll read this arc of six.
Yeah.
Or going back to like the X-Men's from the 60s or whatever, if you pick up one issue, it will tell you what's happened in the last one.
Yeah.
You go, oh, here's Cyclops with his Cyclops beam. He got his powers from XYZ. It's like, yeah, thanks. You don't have to tell me.
Yeah, that's the whole thing from the 60s and 70s was every comic is somebody's first.
Yeah.
So, you would recap everything all the time.
I mean,
it doesn't make them the most reader-friendly nowadays if you're reading them back-to-back. That's
we've commented about that before. You go, here's Wolverine. Yeah. He's got claws. We know. But yeah, and also, I didn't realise this, and which is the answer to your question. I actually am a fan of Geoff Johns' comics.
Okay.
I'd read some before the podcast, read some in the podcast. I realised, if I'm going to read something of DC, I'll probably read his.
So we've got another comic of his coming up before the end of the year as well, so you'll be looking forward to that.
I will be.
No, that's good. So, I mean, I think a couple of things. I've learned that I talk a lot, and I don't like the sound of my own voice, especially as I've got to edit it for hours on end. But no, I think, generally speaking, I've learned that I'm a lot less critical about changes between comics and films than I thought I was.
Mm-hmm.
I always thought I was one of these people who was, you know, didn't like Watchmen because of the changes, but I realised I don't like Watchmen because it didn't change enough and it wasn't very good.
Yeah.
I've not ever really done this whole read then watch thing. I've always read comics, and when I went to see films I would go, I've read this, you know, great, that's not. I've never done them in that close conjunction. So it's something that you've done previously, but something that I've not really, and I think that's probably what I've learned. I mean, other than the fact that I don't like my own voice.
Yeah, that's something that a lot of people say. I hate my voice, and something that I've learned is that even with a stutter, can't even say it, even with that, I can still have a conversation with you on air and record it, and it's not a pile of shit.
It's not. And I do cut out most of it. I will say, we did have this conversation earlier on in the podcast's history, is how much do you want me to edit the stutter? I think your basic answer was just so it doesn't sound like a pile of shit.
So it makes sense, and I don't just stop talking for like half a minute and then carry on. That would just be not good listening.
But no, I've enjoyed it as well. The other thing I've learned is I've liked getting you to read comic books. I get enjoyment from other people reading comic books. And when you told me about your sister reading Long Halloween earlier, I liked hearing that. And I think that's really what I want to get out of this podcast, if anything, from the few people who listen to it, is I would like them to say, oh yeah, that sounded interesting. I went out and read that comic because of you.
Yeah.
Great. That's what I want to hear.
Well, you enjoy that. I enjoy surprising you with little fun facts and things that I found out to a degree that you go, oh, I didn't know that. Or that's really interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, it comes to mind of the Two-Face being cast in the 60s show and it was Clint Eastwood.
Yeah.
It's quite hard to tell you something that you don't know about comics.
Yeah.
So when I do, I'm like, yes, I've got you. You didn't know that. Fantastic.
No, that's right.
And also, Stan Lee likes to have mayonnaise on his hot dog.
Isn't it mustard?
No, mayonnaise, because you said Hawkeye would be proud.
No, it's mustard.
Looks like we've got a disagreement. Josh, come back on the show.
Civil War 2. I tell you what, we're not covering Civil War 2, I'll tell you that now. Right, is it time, do you think, for the ever so special, prestigious award ceremony?
I believe it is.
Have you got a theme song for this?
I'm not sure why, but the tune of do 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 that came into my head.
Bewitched.
Which is Bewitched, yeah. I don't know why. There you go. Okay. That's our theme tune.
Thank you. Sponsored by Bewitched. Just a little editor's note here. This theme song that Iain was singing was actually I Dream of Jeannie, not Bewitched. But for the sake of the rest of the episode, we are going to go ahead with the Bewitched running joke. Back to the episode. It's time for the Become the Teapot First Inaugural Award Ceremony. Here are your hosts, Iain and Iain. Way, Captain. I'll add some sound effects on, it'll be fine. So, hi Iain, great to be with you here today.
Oh, hi Iain, thank you. That's it.
That's some great banter there. That's how we've made it to 27 episodes, with hot banter like that. A little bit of banter. No, right. Our first award for the evening is the Peter Porker Award for Hammiest Performance. This is the award for our favourite performance delivered without a shred of restraint. We're not talking bad performances here. These are genuinely fun and enjoyable performances that are all the better for having the dial ramped all the way to 11. That's a Spinal Tap reference that Iain won't get.
Oh, I know Spinal Tap.
Have you seen it yet?
No. The nominations are Benicio Del Toro as Jackie Boy in Sin City. Benicio Del Toro again as the Collector in Guardians of the Galaxy. Nicolas Cage as Big Daddy in Kick-Ass. And Ben Kingsley as Trevor Slattery in Iron Man 3.
And the winner is... Well, under any other circumstances, Benicio would have won this hands down. But, as the film Pig has shown, you just can't compete with Nick Cage when it comes to ham. The winner is Nicolas Cage as Big Daddy. Yay! The next award for the evening is the Easter Excellence Award.
Easter eggs have played an important part in the show since the beginning. Well, actually, in episode 2. That's when I began the hunt.
Iain's Egg Hunt.
I'm not yoking you. I love all Easter eggs equally, but some eggs hit harder than others. So the nominations for your favourite Easter eggs are the misplaced Spider-Man 3 poster in The Dark Knight, Stan Lee and Chris Claremont both make a cameo in X3. All of the songs on the Batman Begins soundtrack are named after bats, but track 4 to 9 spell out Batman. Oliver's prisoner number in Arrow is a reference to the first appearance of Green Arrow in More Fun Comics, Topo, the musical octopus in Aquaman, and the Live with Murray Franklin show in Joker uses the same font as Batman, the animated series.
A comprehensive list there, all of which I definitely reacted to in some capacity. But there can be only one winner, so the award goes to... Batman Begins, for the soundtrack that spells out Batman.
To be fair, I actually enjoyed that one, because going back to what I said earlier, that's something that you were like, I didn't know that, and you were like, are these all bats?
It's a multi-layered egg. Sounds disgusting.
Got the shell.
Oh, yeah.
You've got the, yeah, the embryo.
The white, the yolk. They spell out Batman.
I mean, I'm surprised you didn't choose the more fun comics. A funny title.
I did like more. Well, that's just the name of a comic that I like, really. The egg itself was okay. The next award is the Silver Surfer's Abs Awards for Egregious Exposition. I gotta say this now. Fucking hell, I wrote this and thought, oh, this is clever. Exposition is essential, but extraneous exposition exacerbates existing erroneous errors in entertainment, eliminating enjoyment. Anyway, this award is for jarring or pointless exposition. I said that too quick.
I quite liked it.
Oh, okay.
The nominations are Silver Surfer's Abs in Fantastic Four, Rise of the Silver Surfer, Oliver Queen's Po-Faced Voiceover in Arrow, and Aquaman's I Am Iron Man monologue from Aquaman.
Coming as no surprise to anyone, because it's the name of the award, the winner is Silver Surfer's Abs Position. And lastly, it's the Iron Fist Award for Most Anticipated Adaptation.
We may still be waiting for the day that Marvel finally brings Iron Fist to the screen, but until then, there's plenty to look forward to in the year ahead.
The competition is stiff with Eternals, Venom Let There Be Carnage, Spider-Man Far From Home, Morbius, The Batman, Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, Thor, Love and Thunder, Black Panther, Wakanda Forever, and Black Adam coming to the cinemas within the next year. In terms of TV, we have Hawkeye, Miss Marvel, Doom Patrol, Harley Quinn, The Sandman, The Boys, The Umbrella Academy, and Peacemaker, to name just a few.
Well, it's definitely a good time to be a comic book fan, but it's not just our opinion that matters.
That's right. We've had a number of guests on the show over the last year, so we thought we'd give them a chance to answer this one.
And also it fills up more of our runtime. So, assorted guests, what's the adaptation that you're most looking forward to?
Hello, Iains. It's John Coxon here. Listeners may remember me from those two episodes where Iain was moving and I had to talk to Iain. Iain has asked me to do a snippet for this episode, and he says I have to say hello, which I've done, and introduce myself, which I've done. He says I have to tell you all what the upcoming comic book adaptation I'm most looking forward to in the next year is, and he's given me a tip: try and use a full sentence. For example, the comic book adaptation I'm looking forward to most in the year ahead is... dot, dot, dot. So, the comic book adaptation I'm most looking forward to in the year ahead is probably a toss-up between Moon Knight and Ms. Marvel. Huge fan of both characters from the comics. Probably more excited about Ms. Marvel, if I'm honest. I think that's going to be amazing. And then, the year after that, we're going to get Rogue Squadron. And if Iain doesn't invite me back onto the podcast, I am going to be slightly sad. Iain wraps up his instructions to me with point five, say goodbye. And so, I will do that. Goodbye.
Hello, fine listeners. I'm Kate. You might know me from such things as being Iain's girlfriend and Kate's opinions. The adaptations that I'm most looking forward to in the year ahead are She-Hulk and Umbrella Academy Season 3. Although She-Hulk hasn't got an official release date, I'm excited for this purely because of Tatiana Maslany, having been really impressed with her portrayal of several very different characters in Orphan Black. I can't wait to see how she brings She-Hulk to life. I'm also really looking forward to the new season of Umbrella Academy, due mid-2022, because I loved the first two seasons, and I'm intrigued as to how it will approach Elliot Page's character story following the fantastic news of his transition to his authentic self. That's all from me. Thanks very much. Bye!
Hi, I'm Hayley, and you may know me from the Valentine's episode, where you can hear me swoon over my favourite Marvel couple, Wanda and Vision. The adaptations that I'm most excited for is the next run of the MCU, and it's hard to say which one I'm most excited for, as I'm hyped up for all of them. in particular the next Spider-Man and Doctor Strange films, as I want to see more of the timeline-breaking bizarreness that we've started to see from the Disney Plus shows. And if the Multiverse of Madness is a proper Lovecraftian horror, it could be amazing. Moving away from the MCU, I am excited for the Neil Gaiman Sandman adaptation coming to Netflix, as the casting and the work I've seen going into it makes it look very promising. Keep on listening. Bye!
Hey, hey guys, I'm Luke. You may remember me from such wonderful things as that one episode we did Sin City in. As for which upcoming comic book adaptation I'm most interested in is the Spider-Man, mainly because I really enjoy those kind of alternate universe mashups like that. And when Alfred Molina showed up, I was all boy. Thank you very much for having me. Bye-bye.
Hello, this is Josh, star of the critically acclaimed episode about Marvel's Civil War. The comic book adaptation that I'm looking forward to the most is Matt Reeves' The Batman, even though it's a story that's been pretty much done to death. I think the cast is too good to ignore. So yeah, looking forward to that. Looking forward to our Pats, or our Bats, if that counts. Yeah, can't wait. Bye.
Hi, I'm Chrissy of Watchmen episode fame. The adaptation that I'm most looking forward to in the near future is Spider-Man No Way Home, because if you know one thing about me, it's that I absolutely love a crossover. And the one thing I love more than a normal crossover is a multi-universe crossover. It may not happen, but if we get to see all the last three Spider-Mans fighting Doc Ock, Electro, and a host of other Spider-Man villains, I'm going to be very excited indeed. Goodbye.
Ha ha ha! Some outrageous choices there.
I can't believe what John said. Outrageous. And Josh, I mean, bloody hell.
Those guys, can you believe them? With guests like that, who needs enemies? Wait, hold on.
With the guests like that, who needs hosts? Wait, no, hold on.
Yeah, no, that was a good point, actually. Actually, if you listen to those episodes, I think you find out why we're the hosts.
Screw you guys.
Thank you all for coming on. Iain, we'll answer this one now, shall we? What is the comic book adaptation that you're most looking forward to in the year ahead?
I mean, like you said there in the intro to that question, awards, ceremony, nominations, whatever. There's so many to look forward to. A couple that I am personally looking forward to is Invincible Season 2, mm-hmm. Peacemaker show, purely because it's all by James Gunn. Thor 4, more Thor, I assume that's the title. Because I'm excited to see what happens with Jane coming back.
Yeah.
And obviously there's the sad news of passing of Chadwick, which I'm intrigued how they're going to work that into Black Panther 2. Mm-hmm. But I would say probably the two things I'm most looking forward to is Spider-Man No Way Home and Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. Purely because, I mean, the What If show has shown what they can do. And I think if I'd not watched that, I wouldn't be as excited for these films. But actually coming off the back of Loki and then into What If, I think that those two films, it's the pinnacle of the turning point for like phase four into phase five.
Yeah.
What about you?
Yeah, no, so there's a huge amount coming out. But I think the one I'm going to plump for is going to be The Sandman, the Netflix adaptation that they're doing. Cast is really shaping up very nicely. I'm a big fan of the comic book, of Neil Gaiman in general, mm-hmm. and really enjoying the audible audio drama that they're doing on there at the moment. If they manage to bring that to the screen as well, that style, it's going to be excellent.
Yeah.
It's already one of my favourite comics, but yeah, it could be one of my favourite comic adaptations as well. So that is the one I'm looking forward to the most. Also, tentatively looking forward to Why the Last Man. I know it's had some production difficulties, mm-hmm. but it's nearly to the screen. They are showing trailers and all sorts now. We will see.
Yeah. Whenever things have had issues with production or editing or whatever it is, they don't normally turn out good.
It's worrying, but I'm going to remain cautiously optimistic.
So I assume for the next few episodes, until its release, you won't be saying much because you'll be holding your breath.
Well, I won't go that far. It's only a TV show, isn't it? Right. I think that's it for the episode, unless you have any other business.
Oh, I wasn't too sure if you'd ask me that, so it's not like I'd planned a tagline quiz.
That's good. Well, in that case, thank you very much for listening, everyone.
No, let me do my tagline quiz.
Okay. What is a tagline quiz?
Right, so I will be saying taglines mm-hmm. from films and only films that we've covered in the last year.
Okay.
These are taken from IMDb.
Right.
So to be honest, some of these taglines I didn't know existed.
And some of them might not exist if it's from IMDb. Someone just made those up.
Well, yeah. So good luck to you. So five films.
Okay.
Okay. With a massive 10 points. Because what I've done, I've put down two taglines per film.
Okay.
If you can answer it on the first tagline, you get 2 points.
Right. Okay. I think I understand.
Are you ready?
I'm ready. Is there a theme song for this part?
Tagline. Got to guess the tagline.
It's very similar to the award ceremony theme tune.
No, I don't think it was. I didn't say tagline in that.
It's a good point. All right. Well, I'll allow it.
Right. Okay. So, yeah. I honestly don't know what you'll get on this. So
I don't know what we'll get from it either.
Right. So, first film, first tagline is One More Time.
One More Time.
It's not the Daft Punk comic.
I was going to say, yeah, is it that the one? One More Time.
Oh, sorry. No. Let's start that again.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. It's One Last Time. One Last Time.
This is a great start, is what I'll say. One Last Time. I mean, it's going to be the final film of a trilogy or... So what have we done? X-Men 3, The Last Stand.
Do you want that to be your final answer or do you want to hear the second tagline of this film?
Is that how this works? So if I get it right on the first one, I have to lock it in. I can't hear the second one.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not convinced. Yeah, let's hear the second one. Sure.
His time has come.
Logan.
Well done.
There we go.
You've got a point.
Yes. Yeah. First time for everything.
Okay. Next film. First tagline. This summer, the bad will fight for good.
This summer, the bad will fight for good.
Correct.
That could be loads of stuff. Guardians of the Galaxy.
Are you going to lock that in or do you want the second tagline?
I feel like I'm halving my points by not locking it in. Well, all right, I'm going to lock that in, but I want the second tagline anyway.
Okay. All right, I might not do the whole you got to lock it in thing. Okay, do you want to keep with Guardians after
I'll
this?
I'll keep Guardians of the Galaxy. So right, after what's the second one?
This tagline then. So, the power of seven become a League of One.
Oh.
You're sticking with Guardians.
I'm going to go with the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. Thank you.
Well done.
Yeah.
Well done. You've got Thanks. 2 points.
So far, half the points.
The next film, the first tagline. Whose side are you on?
Right. I'm going to lock this one in. I'm going to say it straight away. Captain America Civil War. Locking it in.
Okay. You're locking it in.
Locking it in.
You don't want to hear the last clue. Last tagline.
We might as well. We've got to fill the time, haven't we?
Oh, no. I thought that's why we had the guests on.
We can cut those.
United we stand, divided we fall.
Sticking with my answer.
Sticking with that one.
Yeah.
Okay, you're correct.
Hey.
2 points. That's 4 points. Next film. Whose side will you be on?
What?
Whose side will you be on?
What are you talking about? Whose side will you be on? I honestly don't know what the hell that means. I'm going to say it is Days of Future Past.
Do you want the second tagline?
Give me the second tagline.
Take a stand.
Ah, The Last Stand. I said it earlier. I said the wrong X-Men film.
The Last Stand. Yeah, you've got a point. That's 5 points.
Whose side will you be on? Yeah. Free me. I thought it was like a future anyway.
And the last film, the first tagline.
Don't like this game.
Even Heroes Fall.
Even Heroes Fall. What if we... What? Can I look at our schedule?
You can do.
What have we actually
I've not
watched?
Stopped you from having a
All
list
of
our
sudden,
films.
I've forgotten what every film we've watched in the last... Hold on.
Who said hold this hold podcast on. Is not professional?
I forgot I could just look at things. I thought I could just Google these things.
You could have, in the same room as I've got pulled up IMDb.
So what were we doing?
So the tagline to the film is Even Heroes Fall.
Even Heroes Fall. Well, of course, that's going to be... still, none of these are jumping out to me. Who has fallen in any of these things? Even Heroes Fall.
Would you like the second tagline?
I think I would like the second tagline, yes.
Prepare for heavy metal.
Oh, is it Fantastic Four Rise of the Silver Surfer?
Are you going to lock that in?
I'll lock it in.
Oh, so close. Iron Man 3.
Oh, of course it is. Because you fell in that so many times. Those are terrible taglines for that film, is all I'll say.
I didn't write them. I found them.
I'm sorry. I'm getting angry at you for this. So what did I get? Like 4 points there?
So you got 5 out of 10.
All right. Well, that's not bad, I suppose.
But you guessed 4 out of 5 films.
Eventually. Yeah, I suppose so.
Eventually.
Yeah. Got there at some point. Thank you very much. Well, that was a lovely way to end our first year of podcasting together. I think that pretty much sums the show up, if anything, is that level of professionalism and well thought out ideas.
Yeah, I mean, I'm hoping people like our podcast more than 5 out of 10, but that's just my personal view.
I'll take it, to be honest. And I'm hoping that, yeah, maybe this segment can just get picked up for its own game show or something on BBC. We'll the tagline quiz.
We've even got a theme tune. Tagline. You got to guess the tagline.
Great.
Got to guess the tagline. Tag. line.
And on that note, thank you for listening to our first year of episodes here at Become the Teapot. Thank you, Iain, for hosting, and thank you all of our guests who have joined us across the year. And again, thank you very much for listening, and do make sure you're subscribed for the next year of episodes.
Oh, does that mean that I can't leave?
I mean, I could just draw a face on a bucket and put it in your chair. It would probably be much the same.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
I'm off to cry now.
If you have any questions or comments and want to get in touch, you can email us at becometheteapot@hotmail.com or tweet us at becometheteapod. We're also available on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Reddit. Next episode, we're returning to the format as we kickstart our second year by swinging by the franchise that launched 1,000 memes. We revisit Sam Raimi's Spider-Man from 2002 and compare it to a handful of early Spider-Man comics, including Amazing Fantasy 15, Amazing Spider-Man 39-40, and Amazing Spider-Man 121-122.
He'll do the whipping. We'll do the quipping.
See you then. That'll do.
Easter eggs. I'm not sure why I chanted that.